Thank you so much, Ashok sir. My name is Apurva.
Hi, I'm Aseem.
And today we are going to talk about life around us.
So, but Apurva, you think we should sit here and talk about life around us?
Not really, isn't it?
Then what should we do?
I think we need to go out, because biology is best studied where it is found, in nature.
True. So, let's go outside, try to find some things and then come back.
Sounds like a plan.
Okay, chalo.
Oh, so many of them.
It's an ant, right?
Yes.
So what do they have in their mouth?
Looks like they're bringing mud from inside.
And then building their house?
Yeah, that means that they must be making a house inside the ground.
That's cool.
Yeah, see those ants.
See, they're coming out with something in their mouth.
Ah, this is a bigger one, right?
Yes, and it doesn't seem to be carrying anything.
Perhaps it's the one who protects small ants. See, another one is coming out. Perhaps we are here and then they sense it.
Oh, so they are bringing out the defenses, is it?
Yeah. So you see, these small ones are actually taking out the soil.
And
big ones are coming out to defend them.
Okay, so the small ones are doing the building work.
Yeah.
And the big ones seem to be going around trying to look for threats.
Cool.
Very cool. You can do really cool things, you know, with these ants, because you can find them everywhere. Even in your house.
Yeah, always.
Yeah. So if you ever find a line of ants inside your house, you can try putting an obstacle in between, or maybe squeezing some lime juice in their path. And then see how they react to it and what they do. Could be quite an interesting way to learn some biology, isn't it?
Certainly. So we observe things and then we think about what are the possible reasons.
Absolutely.
That's a cool way to do biology, right?
Yes. And insects are very cool things to observe.
Oh, look here, Apurva. What is this? Can you see these marks?
Ooh.
What do you think that is?
Did somebody visit the ants?
I think so. So these are birds' footprints.
Oh, nice.
And what you are looking at, you can see three clear digits, right? So can you guess which bird is this? Not really, right? But if you stay here and observe more, you will be able to see which bird is coming here. And perhaps it is eating ants. We don't know.
Oh, do you think it came to eat the ants?
I think so. But we need to observe, right?
Yes.
We need to spend some time here.
Maybe we can hide in those trees and keep a watch.
Yeah. See this? Another insect. This one is a flying one, right?
It's got cool blue wings.
Yeah. Let's go inside and check it out. We see insects around us.
Yes.
What do you think this is?
This looks like a bee.
Yeah, but not honeybee, right?
No, it's much bigger.
Yeah, so it's mostly a carpenter bee, because you see it's completely black.
Oh.
Right? And see, these are so tiny things that you see here. Let us see if we can magnify this.
Okay.
I'll try to collect some more things that we can see it later.
Sure.
Okay?
Alright.
Let's find things.
Let's see.
So Apurva, you remember that footprint we saw of the bird? So that gave us a hint, right? Something is there.
Yes.
So do you think we have to really look out for these things?
Absolutely.
To find out what is around us?
Yes. To see the life around us and to see the biology around us, all you need is to keep a watch on the things around you and have an inquisitive mind.
True.
For example, do you see that?
Yeah.
It's a tree like any other, right?
Yeah.
But there's something different going on here.
Yeah, we can see those leaves are cut or something, right?
See these leaves?
Yeah.
They're all eaten up. Again, like Sherlock, this is a clue that there must be something here.
Right.
Isn't it?
We have so many little Sherlocks watching this now.
Absolutely. And every time they see something new, they should look and find what the reason for that is. So let's see what we can find here. Look, something has eaten up all of these leaves. Can we find what has eaten them?
Let's see.
Oh, look. Do you see that? It's not bird poop. It's actually moving. It's a caterpillar. Yes. Looks like it's been eating all the leaves of the tree. Shall we take it inside and see what cool things we can do with it? All right, let's go home, caterpillar.
So we are back. Now let us see what we got. Just going around and looking at things. So see, I got the carpenter bee, the
very
moth.
Nice.
It's a dead moth and a feather. Let's see what this is and we'll talk about it.
It's a lovely blue, isn't it?
Yeah, true. But show us what you got.
So this is the caterpillar. Remember, we found it on the tree. And they belong to a class of insects like butterflies or bees mm-hmm. or moths, which usually start their life as an egg.
Right.
And then go through a lot of changes to finally emerge as the pretty little butterfly that we see flitting around in the garden. Mm-hmm. But most of us have seen that in the textbook.
Right.
But it's quite something else to actually watch it happen, isn't it?
Mm. Can you show us how to do that? I mean, how to make sure that we observe this as well as keep a track of this small egg hatching and then larvae and then butterfly?
It's not really that difficult to do, you know. All you need is your half-eaten tree and a few caterpillars, like the one we found.
Right.
And maybe a few boxes.
Oh, it is for that. Okay.
Yes. So, using this box, you can make a small little home mm-hmm. for our caterpillars. Mm-hmm. And then watch them grow and turn into butterflies or moths or some other types of
insects.
Isn't that cool?
Absolutely. So what do you need for that?
So a simple box which is transparent so that you can observe it from all sides.
Yeah.
And just the right size for a few caterpillars to live in. Then the tree on which we found the caterpillar, because the caterpillar is going to eat these leaves, right?
Only these leaves?
Only these leaves, because we found it there.
Okay.
So, you need to feed the caterpillar with these leaves. So, make sure you have a few twigs and leaves of that same tree. Make a cozy home for it. Arrange the twigs such that it can crawl around. And then, your home for the caterpillar is ready.
Nice.
Look, this is the one that we found.
Yeah, right.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
And it looks just like bird poop.
Actually, I was going to say that.
But it is not, because it moves and it's a caterpillar.
Right.
But it's a trick that the caterpillar plays so that other predators don't come and eat it.
Yeah, who is going to come and eat poop?
Exactly. And while we collected these, look, there's another smaller one as well.
Oh, right.
So in they go. And there's a bigger one too.
Right. Can I use this?
Sure.
Oh, yeah. So it looks like a smaller version of the bigger caterpillar that we have seen, right?
Exactly. Tinier bird poop.
Tiny, yeah.
And then you cover the box with a lid, because otherwise the caterpillars may crawl out.
Yeah.
Or some other enemies of it, like
ants that we saw.
Or the lizards that are there around the house, they can come and eat these caterpillars.
Okay.
So we need to take care that that doesn't happen. So we cover the box. You can also put a plastic sheet if you don't have a box with a lid. But make sure that you poke some holes in it.
Right.
Using some pointy thing like a fork or a maybe sharp pencil or something like that. And why do you think we need to do that?
To make sure they breathe oxygen. I mean, there is movement
of
air.
Exactly. To keep, just like our house, we need to keep their house well ventilated as well.
Right.
So,
nice.
We make holes and then our little caterpillar house is ready.
Hmm.
But again, just like we need to keep our house clean,
right. You
need to keep the caterpillar house clean too.
Yeah, because we make it dirty.
If you don't, this is what you will find.
What is that?
Can you see that?
Yeah, there are some round things, droplets.
So what do you think when a caterpillar eats away all of these leaves?
Right. It poops.
It poops.
Right.
And all of that poop will accumulate at the bottom of your box.
Okay.
So once in every day, you need to take all of the twigs out, taking care that the caterpillar doesn't crawl away, clean out the box, and fill it in again with fresh leaves.
Okay.
And after a few days, the caterpillar will grow and become a little fat and a little more fat, and eventually it will find a small piece of twig, crawl under it, and build a lovely cocoon.
Nice.
And
out of the cocoon, perhaps we'll able to see a new butterfly or even a moth come out, right?
Yes. After a few days, as the body of the caterpillar slowly starts changing, the cocoon will become a little transparent, and you'll be able to see a tiny little butterfly all folded up inside the cocoon.
Okay.
And then one fine day, it will emerge. It will dry its wings and fly away.
Great.
But make sure that you leave the box open for that day.
Yeah. But this is what you have done, right?
Yes.
What do you want these guys to do?
Well, I'm sure they will find a lot of caterpillars in and around their gardens and their houses.
Right.
Why don't you take a caterpillar like this and try to rear it in a box? And please send us the pictures of both caterpillars as well as the moths or the insects that come out of them. Right?
Right. Cool. So let me show you what I got, Apurva. You know, I was thinking, this is what we can see with our naked eyes, right? The things that you also showed. So can we try and magnify things and see what else we can see other than what we normally see around us?
That's what many scientists do, isn't it?
Absolutely. But they use this high-fundo microscopes which are available in labs and so on. So I was thinking perhaps we can make a microscope out of a jam bottle.
A jam bottle?
Yeah. So I've kept some things there. Can you just help me get those?
Sure.
I'll show you how to do that.
All of this?
Yes. Thanks a lot. I'll tell you what it is. And I'll tell you also how to make this so that you can do all this at home. So what you require is a simple glass bottle that we have. A pickle bottle, achar ki bottle or jam ka bottle. What you need to do is you have to make sure it is completely clean. You have to invert it. We'll need a mirror, a piece of mirror. If you don't have a mirror, you can use an old CD, cut it out and then use it. You have to put it like that inside so that it is at a slanting position. The lid is very important. So Apurva, may I use this?
Of course. Yeah.
So what we need to do is we have to make very small holes, right, in this lid. So perhaps you can see this. These are very small, tiny holes. So on that, what I've done was, I've used a cello tape to cover them, right? So what is going to happen is, now these holes will be the ones through which we see, right? So if now I ask you to see what is below this or on this bottle, will you be able to? Not really, I know.
No.
So for that, we may want to make sure we make a lens, something like you see here, so that we can magnify it. So what I have is this. What do you see?
Water.
Absolutely. So from water, we are going to make a lens.
But aren't lenses made of glass?
Absolutely. But this is our microscope, right? So we want to make sure that a very small drop is made at the top of this hole. And this drop will be sort of spherical or hemispherical.
Oh, so now, that's what makes the lens.
Absolutely. So now, when you go close and when you move this up and down, you'll be able to see small things. So for example, you have you have dirt around, or you have small salt particles around and so on.
Grains of sand,
exactly. Some pieces of leaves or flowers, you pollen, right?
Yes.
You see pollen. So all that you can use to magnify. So what you need to do is, you just have to put those things here on top and use this to zoom in, to magnify, right? So quickly, I have some sand there. Can you just get it? So I got some small sand particles. Perhaps I am hoping you can also see maybe some ants or some small insects that are there. So I put sand here and I go in close and just move this. And you can see small particles, right? So this is one way of actually magnifying things.
Very cool. You know, there's a very tiny little caterpillar on this leaf. Maybe we can put that as
absolutely.
Well.
Absolutely. We can do that. So this is something that you can make very easily. Now sometimes it may happen that you won't be able to get this glass, right? Or the mirror. So what you can do is, you can use a torch, right? What you need to do is you have to put it inside here. Just make sure that it's a small one. And make sure that the light is coming up.
So instead of the mirror, you use the torch.
You use the torch or this, right? Mm-hmm. You all sort of have mobile phones. So you can use this as a light source. So what I am actually trying to tell you, Apurva, is that we are studying biology, right? Life around us.
Mm-hmm.
But for that, we actually are taking help of some physics principle, right? The optics.
Like reflection.
Absolutely. And the lens or the shape of the lens, right? So it will be interesting for you guys to actually think about why a spherical drop is making sure that you can magnify things if you see through it. So this is something I want you to find out and sort of give us the answers through email, or you can put it in your comments, right? But along with that, I was also thinking that if we can see all these small, I mean, things that we got around. So this is a carpenter bee. This is a moth or a feather, right?
Mm-hmm. I think it belongs to a kingfisher.
Why do you say so?
Because I saw one flying around, and just after that you found that feather.
Okay, and kingfisher also has the blue coloration, right?
It's just the right blue.
So I was thinking, if you can magnify these things, maybe some parts, and if we can see some new things, right, that we don't see otherwise with our naked eye.
I wonder how all of this will look up close.
We can do that, right?
Let's try.
So one is, you can use this kind of a microscope. But since,
or this kind of
or
a microscope,
that, yes.
A very simple one.
A very simple one. So this is a simple one. The ones that people use are those are there in schools are mainly compound microscopes. So I was thinking, if we can use this, right, the high piece of technology that we have in our hand, because it has camera and all these things, right? So can we sort of exploit this and convert it into a microscope, mm-hmm, so that we can see and study biology or life around us?
Do you have any trick for that?
Absolutely. So, I'm going to use one more thing that is here.
Water again?
Not really.
I don't think you should put water on your phone.
No, absolutely not. So, I'll tell you what I have. So, here, what I have is this. Do you know what this is?
Oh, that's like a bead, isn't it?
Absolutely.
It's a dry one and then it drinks up all the water and becomes big.
So, these things we get all around us, right?
Right.
They are mainly used for decoration and all this kind of stuff.
I've seen them in a fish bowl as well.
Absolutely. So these are called as Orbeez, right? So with the Orbeez, I think we can make a better lens and use it with the phone.
Mm-hmm.
Can you think of any idea how to do that?
Perhaps we should put our selfie camera to better use than taking our own picture.
Yeah, sure. So, let
why
us
don't
try
you try
this.
Putting the Orbeez on the
yeah. So I can
phone.
Do that here, right? But the thing is, the Orbeez won't stay
it
there.
It will just keep slipping off.
So can you think of something that we can
something.
Use?
Let me see if I can find something here.
What do you have there?
It's just a loop of a wire, but perhaps I can twist it.
Yeah, right.
So that we can put the Orbeez on it.
I can help and do that. Great, it's working, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
can
now,
you put it on the camera?
Yeah, I'll do that. Okay, just on the camera. And then what?
So normally, when we have a lens like this, this is the thing that we move.
Yeah, so you move the lens.
Yes. But it will be very difficult to move your Orbeez along with your phone, right? So why don't we move the thing that we want to observe instead?
Yeah, so let us go, with the carpenter
bee. With the carpenter bee.
Right. So wait. Now this is what is the best part, right? Now whatever you are going to see, I can video record, right?
Very
so
good.
Let me start recording. It's on. And let us see what we find.
Do you see the leg of the carpenter bee?
Yes.
It looks quite bushy.
Something is there, right?
Yeah. Should we see up close what it looks like?
Sure. Let's hope this works.
Let's see if it does.
Oh yes.
Oh yes.
Oh, these are small little hairs.
So, it's not just a long leg.
What is at the end of that?
It has got
leg.
A lot of small hair.
Absolutely.
Like this. Can you see that?
Is it a claw? It looks like a
claw,
right?
It looks, and right at the tip of the leg,
Right.
What you see is a claw-like thing.
Right.
Can you make it sharper?
So you just have to move your hand?
Yeah, you just have to move your hand
awesome.
To just the right distance to make it the sharpest.
Okay.
And
great.
Wow. We wouldn't have been able to see that just with our eyes.
Absolutely not. Then let us now try and see this feather, right? How it looks. So now you can see it's very blue and brown. Let us see how it looks when it is magnified. Oh, you actually can't see the blue that clearly, right?
Mm, it looks all white.
Yeah, let me twist it. And let us see whether you're now, right?
The blue
now
comes
you can see
and
the blue.
Goes,
right.
Isn't it?
Right. And you see that blue is only on the main parts or main lines of the feather, right?
So
and not everywhere.
All of the threads are blue.
Right. And only when I put it at an angle, you are able to see it very clearly.
Some physics
right?
again.
Absolutely. So this is not a pigment that is coming out of the feather.
Mm.
But the light is getting something. You have to find what it is. So that we are looking at the blue color from the feather. Right? There is one more thing that we can do. So I'll pause this. You know, right? We have the laser pointers that we use to play and so on, the red one and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking if we can use that to make another lens and try to see whether we can magnify other things. So what is going to happen is I'm going to ask you to get the laser pointer from there and let's see what we can do. That's it. Yeah. So I'm sure they are wondering how come everything is ready here and we are finding everything. But we do our homework, that's the only thing. So, now here, when you open this.
Oh, so you've taken it apart.
Yeah, so I've opened it,
mm-hmm.
opened the mouth of it. And inside, you actually can see a small lens is there. Now you can use this lens, right?
So do all laser pointers have that?
Yes, all these laser pointers have that. Try to get the old one that is not working, not the new one. I'm sure most of these kids have this at home. So the main reason I'm saying this is most of the time this selfie cameras, you can't zoom in, you can't move them, right? But this camera, the main cameras are very important for this. So if you can use this lens to magnify, we can do that. And I need one more thing from you,
mm-hmm.
your hairpin. Yeah,
my hairpin.
Just give me, I'll tell you
for
why.
A microscope.
Yeah.
Let me see if I can find one.
I lost mine, sorry.
yes. I think I have one.
And a cellotape. Can you get the other?
Yes. There you go.
Thank you. Okay.
So what are you going to do with my hairpin?
So I have this. I'm going to use it as a holder. So my lens can fit in. Like this. And I'm going to put this over the camera. And
exactly over the aperture of the camera.
Yes, yes. And just put a tape.
Not on the lens, just on the holder.
Just on the holder so that it doesn't move. Right? And then we have it. You want to try?
Of course.
So let me open the camera. Now no more selfie. And now this moth. So you were talking about the caterpillars and the moth, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is the moth I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to use it and zoom it in? I'll just start the video recording. Now see what this is.
Oh, it looks so cool.
Absolutely. So this is magnification of the moth wings. You see those spots?
Oh yes. They don't look like that when you see it like that.
Absolutely.
With just your eyes.
Absolutely. And if I...
And there are small scales, isn't it?
That is what I'm trying to show you. So if you magnify it a bit, you can actually see it is made up of small hair or scales.
They're
right?
sort of arranged like this.
Absolutely.
In a line.
So, the thing is, even moths and butterflies have hair or scale-like things on their wings. Did you know that?
Not really.
Not really, right?
So, you know these things only when you see them up close
that
and
is
observe
the idea.
Them for
that
a long
is
time.
The idea. So, they are around us, right?
Mm.
But perhaps we need a better eyes through these lens to see all these things, right? So see Apurva, with the same one,
we can see those.
Oh, is that the eye?
Yes. So the compound eye, I'll show it.
Is it eye or eyes?
So that is something very interesting, right? So these insects have eyes which are compound eyes. So that's why they are big, right? But not just that. So you are able to see that little antenna as well as the eye. And if you could develop even better one, or if you have a better phone, you are able to zoom in and also see those little eyes which are on top of its head, which we normally don't see, right? So these are the things that you can easily do and find stuff which is around us and study them in a different way, right? So Apurva, you see this small lens, right? A spherical one. So in the 17th century in Holland, so there was this man called as Anthony van Leeuwenhoek. He actually made such small lens, and he was the first one to develop.
Isn't he the one who actually first developed a microscope?
Microscope, exactly, simple one. So, but obviously his microscope was the beginning, and now we have so many other microscopes, right? So all these things we can see using the technology that he has started with, and we can use it now at home, right? And the things around us, we can easily sort of see them, right? The hair that we saw on the carpenter bee, or even the moth wing where we saw the scales, right? The ants, and even the feather that we saw, right? So all these things are just the beginning of exploration and looking at things in different ways.
Of life around
us. Absolutely, absolutely. So he could use, Anthony could use this microscope and see different cells, different parts, right? So this is what we see, the insect world and the feathers, etc., right? What about plants? Can we also see plants?
Can we see really small things in the
plant? Yes, we can do that. But the thing is, sometimes, see, all this was colorful, right? And we could see it. Many things, these cells, etc., are not really colorful. They, if you look them very close, they are completely transparent, so you won't be able to see. So a solution to that is, we can stain them, sort of color them, right?
Put some ink.
Absolutely. So chemically, there are many stains which can be used, and you can see all these things, right? But at home, do you think we can make any stains?
Can we use something which inherently has some color?
Like?
Carrots, beetroots.
Beetroot, right?
Yes.
So, I know you will give this answer. So, I have prepared a sort of solution of beetroot. We get it from there.
Sure.
And also, there are some slides that I've made of plant material. Yeah, just one is enough. Awesome.
Here you go.
Yeah, so this
and
is actually...
here is your beetroot juice.
Thank you. Thanks. So you know how can we prepare this juice or beetroot solution?
Well, just cut up some pieces of beetroot, put them in a little bit of water, and boil and boil and boil and boil. Till all of the red color comes into the water. And then cool the water, put it in a jar.
And we get this red color solution, right? So this we can actually use to stain, right? One way is, another way to show this is, so I have made this slide where, which you can see actually this is a piece of a leaf or a petal, right? I also have another slide which has an onion root peel, right? So these are colorful things which you can see, but the onion root peel you can't see.
So these you don't need to stain with
absolutely
beetroot or
but
other things
this one you need to stain,
color.
Right? So quickly we'll have a look at that slide. Sure. And see how we can use this.
So, this looks like thin peelings of onion?
Absolutely. So, these are thin peelings of onion, right? So, here you can see, this is a radiant one, right? So, this, I have used few drops of your beetroot solution to stain. And this one, I have used iodine. You know the iodine solution that we have that we put on our wounds?
Right, the one that we put when we get a scratch.
Absolutely.
Or...
so that I have put here. So you can actually see all those things which are transparent and stain them with such different stain that we can make at home.
So that you can see the structure better.
Right.
With the color it comes
absolutely
out and you can see the structure much
better. And you can see the cell walls, you can see things inside. You can see different parts, different tissues also. Right. Now, we don't have time to show all of this.
But can you see that with your...
yes, so I've tried that.
Microscope with your laser pointer lens?
Yes, so you can do this. You can actually see this. And you can see those structures, right?
Okay.
But I'm not going to show them.
going to ask these guys to make it and share with us.
Yes.
Another thing is, if you don't have slides at home, so you see, you can use these short plastic papers, like transparencies, etc., to make slides.
So any this is thick plastic paper.
Absolutely.
Just cut it up.
Yeah.
And
make a sandwich. So whatever you want to see, So these are the wings of. This is a wing of this kind of a carpenter bee.
Mm-hmm.
And now, I just hold it like this, make a sandwich, and put it under our microscope. Or if you are going to use this Orbi microscope, you can put it on top also.
Hmm.
Right?
So that you don't have to hold the wing itself.
Absolutely.
And it will not keep moving.
Right. And I'm sure these guys will also think of making their own microscope, making an assembly where they can put the phone, they can have the slide below the phone and they will have their hands free.
So the great Indian jugaad.
Absolutely. So this is about what we can see with these microscopes, right? Do you think there is still a world that we can't see with these microscopes and require something else?
I think so. So this is already, you know, quite small.
Right.
But what about the biology around us, which is even smaller?
Mm-hmm.
For that, you will need very sophisticated microscopes to actually see it. Right. These are called?
Bacteria.
Yes. One of the things that are very, very small, but are present all around us in nature are bacteria.
So inside my gut, on my skin.
Around in the air around you, in the soil, in the water, everywhere.
Right.
But even if we are not able to see them without sophisticated microscopes, we can still feel their presence.
Like what?
Not just that, we use them as well every day.
Really?
Can you think of an example?
Where we use bacteria every day, right?
Yes.
Making curd?
Yes. You use the bacteria to make curd and you actually eat them up.
Yes, I didn't think of that in that way. But
that's how your bacteria get into your gut.
Okay.
But there are some cool experiments that you can do with making of curd.
Yes, sir.
Let's see.
Okay.
So let's clear some space here.
Yeah, sure.
So what I've got here is all the ingredients that we need for making curd, which is milk and more curd.
Yeah.
Because that's how we make curd, right?
So we start with some curd first.
With some curd, which I have here.
Okay.
And normally, we use a bowl of milk, right?
Mm-hmm.
A bowl of milk that is not too hot, not too cold, just lukewarm.
Right.
But to do this experiment, I have two other bowls of milk. One, which is quite cold.
Yeah,
and one which is boiling hot, just off the stove.
I can see the
stove.
Yeah.
Did you see some steam coming out of it?
Yeah.
So I've taken equal quantities of milk in each of these, and I'm going to add equal quantities of curd.
You are stuck at equal, right?
Yes.
Why is that?
Because if I don't use equal quantities of milk or equal quantities of curd, whatever I see tomorrow, I will not know whether it is because I've heated the milk at different temperatures or is it because I took different amounts of milk.
Okay.
Right?
That makes sense, yes.
Yes. So you need to keep some things constant and change at just one thing at a time.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
I hope our audience is also noting this.
Yes. That's how you do experiments.
Right. At home.
So, a bit of curd in the hot milk.
Mm-hmm.
More or less the same in the lukewarm milk, and the same amount in the cold milk, and let's mix them up well. Can you put on some labels on the bowls for me?
Sure. So this is, I think, H for hot.
That's H for hot.
I put it like this.
Okay.
Not sticking.
This is the normal milk. That's not the cold.
Oh, sorry. This is the cold one.
And this is the cold milk. So hot, normal, and cold. Mix it up very well and keep it at a cool, dry place for about 8 to 10 hours.
Okay.
Just like our grandmother did.
Right.
But this is exactly what I did yesterday as well.
Right.
And I have three more bowls of hot milk curd normal milk curd and cold milk curd. Okay. Let's see what has happened to them. Right. So you see, if you use a fresh spoon, the curd which I made with boiling hot milk, well, there's no curd really.
You're right.
It's just milk with some, I don't know, stringy particles. So no curd. The one with the cold milk, well, there's some curd.
Yeah, it looks like something has formed.
Some sticky mass.
Right. But not a very hard curd that we normally
eat. Not the dahi that we really like, right? But whereas the curd made with lukewarm milk, just perfect. See?
Yeah.
Just right to eat.
Right.
Isn't it? So what do you think is happening here? And how do you think we are able to see the presence of bacteria here? So what happens when we mix curd in milk is that the bacteria, which are mainly species of a bacteria called lactobacilli, get mixed with the curd and in milk, sorry, get mixed with the milk, and in milk there is a sugar called lactose. So the bacteria use this sugar to as food and eat and grow, and in the process convert the lactose into a product called lactic acid.
Acid.
Yes.
Okay.
So since it's an acid, what will it do to the pH of the milk?
It will change it, will reduce it.
Exactly. So it makes the pH of the milk lower, which is acidic. And because the pH of the milk now becomes acidic, what happens to other proteins like casein in the milk is they start changing their shape because of the change in pH. And what you get is wonderful curd like this.
Nice.
So that's how normal curd forms. But when you use hot milk, what happens is all of the bacteria, what do you think will happen if you put bacteria in boiling hot milk?
Most probably they will die.
Absolutely. They die, and hence no bacteria, no conversion of lactose to lactic acid, and no curd. Whereas in super cold milk, what do you think happens?
So I think they will freeze, but they will not die perhaps.
So they freeze and they try to grow, but what the temperature they like best is around 37 degrees, which is our lukewarm milk, right?
Okay.
So when they are put in temperature which is colder than that, they try to grow, but they are not quite able to do it well.
Okay.
So what results is this stringy, weird kind of thing.
Okay.
Right? So this is what, or this is a simple experiment that you can do with making of dahi, where you can see the difference that it makes when you change the temperature of the milk that you use.
So we are experimenting with bacteria, which we can't see actually.
Exactly.
But still we can actually sort of see their existence or what they do.
So when you went from milk to dahi, this is indirectly you seeing the action of bacteria, right?
True.
So this is how you experience bacteria all around you every day.
No. And but this is also some part of chemistry that we are talking about, right?
Exactly. But I said things like lactose and lactic acid and casein and all of that.
True.
That is all chemistry. But you can never have biology without some bit of chemistry.
That's true.
Right? So all of these different parts of science always come together when it comes to life.
Nice.
And this experiment doesn't stop here. What we did was use different temperatures of milk.
Right.
But what else can you try with?
Perhaps use different milks, maybe milk from cow and milk from buffalo.
Exactly. The same amount of milk from cow.
Right.
The same amount of milk from buffalo or goat or camel if you live in Rajasthan.
Right.
And what else?
Perhaps we can try different amounts of the dahi that we are putting.
Correct. First. Instead of half a spoon, you can try maybe very little.
Right.
Or maybe 2 spoons.
Right.
Or maybe you can heat up the dahi instead of the milk. And
yeah,
see what
we can
happens.
Try that. So basically what you are saying is we'll use different variables to study how things happen, basically experiment.
This is how scientists make their experiments, right?
Yeah.
They keep some things constant, change a few things, few variables at a time, and see what effect it has on their setup. In this case, which is making dahi.
Nice.
So why don't you try different things with making of dahi or maybe making of bread? And try to study the microbes and the bacteria around you in that way.
Nice. So
So we tried to sort of give them a flavor of life around us, going out, looking at trees and the interactions, absolutely. Looking at things through perhaps microscope that we make.
Things that we don't see with our eyes, we can use some devices to see them better.
To see them. But the idea is this is just the beginning, right? So these are just observations. So if you want to study processes, we start with observations.
Yes.
And then later we can continue doing that. Yes. Right?
So ye to sirf trailer tha. Picture abhi.
Baki hai. Okay.
Yes.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Over to you, Ashok sir.
And see you again.
See you again.
Bye.
Bye.